Ek gaan sommer afskop. Dis 'n klippie in my skoen al 'n hele ruk. Is persone wat as anti-vaxxers geëtiketeer word. Dr. Edeling, in u ondervinding teen die beginsel van enting, is COVID-19 enstof tegnies 'n enstof?
Baie dankie Dion, net om te sê ek sal Afrikaans praat. Af en toe mag 'n Engelse tegniese woord inglip waarvoor ek nog nie die Afrikaans ken as dit reg is met jou. Anti-vaxxer is 'n propaganda term wat bedoel is om negatiewe konnotasie te skep oor mense wat ernstig wetenskaplike kommernisse het oor menseregte, menselewens en so voorts. Dit is eerstens verkeerd, die term anti-vaxxer, want die stof wat tans gebruik word onder die naam vaccine teen COVID-19 is glad nie 'n vaksine nie. Dit is 'n eksperimentele genetiese inspuiting waarvan die effekte en langtermyngevolge glad nie behoorlik nagevors is nie. In werklikheid, almal wat nou daardie inspuiting kry, is deel van 'n massiewe eksperiment op die mensdom. Dit is nie 'n vaksine nie. Ons kan meer daaroor ingaan, maar die kort antwoord op jou vraag, dit is nie 'n vaksine nie. Die ander ding is, almal wat ek ontmoet het en mee gepraat het, wie so misken word as anti-vaxxers, is nie anti-vax nie. Hulle is pro-life, pro-human rights en pro-choice. Met ander woorde, dit is mense wat opstaan, wat voorstanders is van menseregte, menselewe en vryheid van keuse.
Dankie Dr. Edeling. Ons het gehoor of ons het gesê dat ethiek gaan oor die besluit van wat reg, verkeerd, goed of sleg is. Dr. Pieter, wat sou u sê is die norme? Hoekom 'n mens sou besluit iets is goed of sleg of reg of verkeerd?
Our standard for deciding what is right and what is wrong must come from the word of God, from the law of God, best summarized in the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments, in fact, are the basis not only of what is right and wrong, but also of our rights. So, for example, the only limitation placed on our speech in the Ten Commandments is you shall not take God's name in vain and you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. So outside of those two limitations, you've got tremendous freedom of speech. The only limitation of conscience in the Ten Commandments is you shall not covet your neighbor's goods and you shall not commit idolatry. So plainly outside that, you've got vast amounts of freedom of conscience. And so again, in the Ten Commandments, it doesn't tell us how we are to practice our church, what the modes of baptism are, and what the church government structure can be. There are varieties in the Bible. So it isn't society that in the English common law, King Alfred the Great began the English common law with these words: I'm the Lord your God who brought you out of the house of bondage, out of slavery in Egypt. You ought to have no other gods before me. And he followed with the Ten Commandments and the case laws of Exodus and also the Sermon on the Mount. And that's the common law. That's the foundation of Western Christian civilization and a Dutch law. And therefore, to me, this is safe. The Magna Carta, the Great Charter, the first Bill of Rights, the first restriction on the powers of government, it's thoroughly saturated with scripture. So when we build our law on God's law, and God only gave us Ten Commandments, which just shows how, it just covers everything. What is a safe society? It's a society where people don't steal your life, they don't steal your wife, they don't steal your neighbor, your property, they don't steal your good name, and they're not jealous and envious and hating you. And so if we obey the Ten Commandments, we have a good neighborliness, stable society, and so the two tablets of the law are the foundation of civilization. And we know that in so many ways. For example, if you go in the House of Lords in England, the two biggest paintings on the wall of the cabinet room of the House of Lords is Moses coming down with the tablets of the law and Ezra reading tablets of law. Outside the Palace of Justice in London is Moses holding the law and King Alfred the Great who put the common law in. Now, when you've got that, you've got a rock solid foundation. But if you avoid that, then you're building on sand, where it is, well, I feel that your rights threaten my rights, and I feel triggered by you saying that, and well, I feel that this isn't fair, and before you know it, you have a mess where everyone's offended and everyone's suing one another. That's sand, and that's the chaos we're seeing in America and South Africa right now, where they've moved away from God's rock onto human sand. So to me, the only way, if a person wants to argue right or wrong in terms of ethical, it should relate to and have its roots in Western civilization, which is summarized the best in the Ten Commandments.
Thank you, Dr. Pieter. Ek wil aan Niek 'n vraag vra. Die media, die owerheid en besigheid gebruik graag statistieke om hulle handelinge te regverdig. Wat sou u sê is die ethiese norme as met data, inligting en statistiek gewerk word? In u ondervinding, kom die data wat in die media aangehaal word ooreen met die data wat julle versamel? Hoekom verskil dit? Indien dit so sou wees.
So the biggest problem is that you can easily lie with statistics. It's simply not difficult. And if people are motivated to promote a false doctrine, then they will lie with statistics. To pick up on what Dr. Hammond was saying, when you see censorship, when you see cancel culture, when you see people being deplatformed based on their views and opinions, there are two things you can know for an absolute certain. The first one is that a grand falsehood is being protected. That's certain. And the second one is that what is being targeted is the truth. So you need to listen. We all need to listen to the dissenting voices at such times. When you hear this phrase, follow the science, you should stop immediately, because there is no such thing as the science. Science is not an institution. Science is a process. It's a way of learning about the world. And so when people are saying to you, we follow the science, you should be aware straight away that those people are lying to you. When it comes to the use of statistics in that kind of process, it's particularly pernicious, because there are so many pitfalls in the analytic and the analysis of data. Society is complex. Human beings are complex. A pandemic is a complex thing. Our economies are a complex thing. And people like me, actuaries and statisticians and demographers and epidemiologists, spend years learning how not to fool themselves by misinterpreting data, by taking too simplistic approach, by not looking at all the variables, by ignoring confounding factors. And so when you see these little simplistic pictograms coming at you, trying to convince you that the vaccines are safe and effective, or that lockdowns work, or that a little cloth mask on your face stops a virus from being transmitted, you need to be very aware. You need to, even if you are not a deeply trained statistician or mathematician, you need to be just aware that somebody is probably trying to manipulate you.
Thanks, Nick. Net, ek wil net vir almal sê, en ek hoor, hierdie uitsending word, of hierdie paneelbespreking word opgeneem, en hy word gestroom na onder andere Facebook toe op hierdie stadium. Vir die mense, vir ons buiten gehoor, julle is welkom om kommentaar te lever op WhatsApp. Die WhatsApp nummer is 060-960-7375. 060-960-7375. Dr. Edeling, rapport plaas op die 15 Augustus 'n berig na aanleiding van 'n opinie teen COVID-19 inentings wat Dr. Susan Vosloo op 'n aanlyn vergadering uitgespreek het. Dr. Vosloo word verdag gemaak oor haar vreemde vriende. In dieselfde media is verskyn 'n berig oor professor Wolfgang Preiserin, 'n viroloog aan die Universiteit van Stellenbosch, wat meen dat entstowwe in 'n kort tyd ontwikkel kon word weens baie kundige navorsers, baie fondse met behulp van techniek van parallel ontwikkeling. Die eindstof is daarom effectief en veilig. Ons sien dus dat een specifieke standpunt of narratief bevorder word ten koste van een kundige en een gesiene dokter. Ook meneer Hudson word in die Financial Mail bygekom in die artikel Nick Hudson and Panda are wrong, believing them is deadly. Dr. Edeling, watter ethiese beginsels meen u behoort die media te volg en wat is die media se plig en verantwoordelikheid in geval van konflikterende standpunte?
Dankie Dion. Die eerste ding wat ek wil uitlig, die gesprek waarin Dr. Vosloo deelgeneem het en wat so wyd verspreid gegaan het en wat volgens daardie media met vreemde mense was, is totaal oneties. In die eerste plek, Dr. Vosloo het deelgeneem op uitnodiging van 'n individu om te praat met vriende en familie van die individu in die context van 'n verjaardag of 'n familiefunksie of iets. Dit was, sy het gepraat met die persoon wat haar uitgenooi het en die vriende en familie van daai persoon. Sy het nie geweet en het geen beheer gehad oor wie anders ook op die Zoom bespreking was nie. So, om daardie berig te plaas, sonder om vast te stel by Dr. Vosloo, het jy gekies wie saam met jou in daardie vergadering is, was myns insiens volgens die media verkeerd. Dit is ook verkeerd om enigies te sê oor wat sy te sê gehad het, sonder om vir haar te vra of sy dit wil ondersteun of verduidelik. So daar is vir my ook klaar twee ethiese oortredings wat die media gedoen het. Die ander berig in dieselfde koerant, dat 'n professor, wie nou natuurlik uit hoofde van sy aanstelling, 'n deskundige behoort te wees, beweer iets wat gewone common sense vir jou moet sê, is nonsens. Ek het geluister na die woorde wat jy gesê het. Hy sê, die feit dat dit die goed vinnig vervaardig is, is nie 'n probleem nie, want die wetenskap het so ver gevorder, dat dit vinnig kon vervaardig word, daarom is dit veilig. Dit is totaal irrasioneel. Want hy het nie bewys dat die wetenskap dit bereik het nie, hy beweer dit, sonder enige bewyse. En al kan hy bewys, die wetenskap het genoeg gevorder om dit so vinnig te ontwikkel. Dit het geen invloed op hoe veilig dit is nie. Nadat die wetenskap enigiets ontwikkel het, moet dit getoets word. Dit is hoekom daar standaard prosedures is van dierestudies, dan fase 1, 2 en 3 mensestudies, wat behoorlik gecontroleer en behoorlik gerapporteer word en wat onafhanklik bevestig moet word, voordat 'n owerheid soos byvoorbeeld SAHPRA kan sê, ja, hierdie middel is veilig en effektief, ons mense kan dit gebruik. So daardie bewering is so onsinnig, ek kan nie glo dat 'n joernalis wat sy kop reg werk, dit so kon aanvaar en skryf nie.
Het ons ander twee meneere dalk 'n opinie oor hierdie geval?
Meneer Hudson was direk aangeval, hy kan vir homself antwoord, maar ek is baie bly as hy dit wil hê dat ek namens hom antwoord. Ek weet baie goed wat meneer Hudson geskryf het en gesê het op verskillende platforms. En as 'n wetenskaplike en as 'n kenner van evidence-based medicine, ek ken nou nie die Afrikaanse term, maar evidence-based medicine is 'n baie sterk fondasie van mediese ethiek en mediese metode. Alles wat Nick Hudson geskryf en gesê het volgens my vermoë, het rationeel, korrek, wetenskaplik en sinvol gelyk. Ek het meer as een keer in die media gesien dat joernaliste probeer om hom uit mekaar uit te trek. En in daai proses, dit is net 'n ad hominem attack. Hulle wys hulle onkunde deur dit wat hulle skryf teen hom. So, eerstens is dit vir my oneties vir enige persoon in die media om 'n kenner aan te vat in sy gebied en sleg te sê of te beledig oor iets wat die joernalis nie verstaan nie. As 'n joernalis nie hou van iets wat 'n kenner gesê het nie, Myns insien sal die korrekte ethiese benadering wees, nooi 'n ander kenner wat soortgelyk gekwalifiseer is, om in oop debat met hierdie een te tree, en dan kan hulle dit bespreek. Maar Nick Hudson kan nie 'n gesprek oor aktuariële metodes hê met 'n joernalis nie, wat met nie met hom saamstem nie. Dit is net sinneloos. Ek het van sy antwoorde gesien, wat baie goed is. So vir my, Dion, was daardie aanvalle op Nick Hudson wat ek gesien het, was heeltemal oneties.
Baie dankie. Dr. Pieter, is die individu wat enstof weier, 'n selfsugtige persoon, het ons 'n plig om te ent? Wat sou u ook sê is die verantwoordelikheid wat gesonde, ongeënte mense, siek mense, geënte mense en mense wat reeds natuurlike immuniteit het teenoor mekaar? Wat is hulle verantwoordelikheid teenoor mekaar?
Historically, we've always worked on quarantining the sick. And this is the first time there's been quarantining the healthy. If a person is sick, you quarantine him. I think that's fair. There was a leopard colony up in Sudan that we were helping the hospital with. And to keep the lepers away from other people because of the danger of contagion, that made sense. When people are contagious, when I had chickenpox and so on, I was quarantined from the rest of the family and so on. These things happen. But to quarantine people who are well makes no sense. And to quarantine people between those who vaccinated and not vaccinated is completely unethical. It's interesting that you are not allowed to ask people's health status questions on things like, do you have AIDS? That's considered unethical. But they can ask, are you vaccinated? Which is bizarre. Because, for example, I'm required to get a yellow fever inoculation to go to the Congo. Now, when I'm in the Congo, I never thought that I was in danger from people who didn't have yellow fever inoculations because I was under the impression that my yellow fever inoculation protected me. So the fact that there were all these people around who doubtless had no yellow fever inoculation didn't bother me in the slightest. And therefore the whole ethics where they've changed it down to, and this is absolutely bizarre, where you no longer have freedom of conscience, where you no longer have freedom of thought, we no longer have freedom of choice. This makes no sense. This is no parallel in history. And Abraham Kuyper, who was a great theologian, and he was Prime Minister of the Netherlands back at the beginning of the 1900s. In 1904, they had a major, I think it was smallpox outbreak, and they wanted some kind of vaccination cards for travel. And as Prime Minister of the Netherlands, he said, you cannot coerce conscience. It is unethical, it is illegal, it cannot be done. We will not have people's freedom of movement in the Netherlands being restricted on the basis of whether they had a vaccination or not. Now that's Abraham Kuyper over 115 years ago. I believe that's where we are now. Right now we're in an extremely dangerous position where journalists in many cases are becoming propagandists or commissars even. Now I know this because I've spent most of my life as a missionary to people in persecuted countries. I've worked throughout Eastern Europe behind the Iron Curtain. I've ministered to communist countries like Mozambique and Angola and so on, everywhere from Albania to Poland. And in the communist countries, you must all adhere to one reality, one truth, one narrative, and the media speaks with one voice. And this was well said by Alexander Solzhenitsyn. Alexander Solzhenitsyn came to the West and he committed the unforgivable sin at Harvard, 1978. He was a darling of the West. He was this refusenik. He was this dissident. He was exiled from Russia. He got the Nobel Literature Award for the Gulag Archipelago. Great man. And then he said, in our Eastern countries, in the Soviet Union, the Warsaw Pact, our media speaks with one voice. We're not surprised. Because we have a one-party dictatorship and the media is controlled by the one party. So the media speaks with one voice. Whether they believe it or not is irrelevant. They must speak with that one voice or they won't be in their job tomorrow. But he says, now I'm in the West. The free, independent West. And your media also speaks with one voice. And it's the same voice I heard behind the Iron Curtain. And then he said the unforgivable sin. He said, who controls the media in the West? And it's like Solzhenitsyn died. I mean, you never heard from him after that. It was, and he lived for a long time. But this is where we've become. I'm afraid our journalists are now mostly propagandists. And I'm afraid a lot of our medical... In fact, I'd call a lot of our journalists prostitutes. They're meant to be journalists, but they become prostitutes. And I'm afraid a lot of our doctors and nurses have also become part of the system. And we know many of them don't believe it. So here's an example. One of our people went to the doctor and was told, do you want the vaccination? She said, it's not safe and it's not necessary. And I think it can be a threat to my health. And the doctor lowered his head and said, I know. So what was he asking? And like being a salesman for it, I think a lot of people are to keep their jobs within journalism or medicine or in the police force are lowering their conscience, violating their conscience. And that's sad. We should be in a society where people are free, whether in journalism or in medicine, to speak honestly.
Thank you, Dr. Peter. Mike.
Can I add a comment quickly? Yeah. I'd like to just play a bit on this word propaganda, because the organization that I was a founder of called PANDA, Pandemics Data and Analytics, started by simply pointing out that as we were entering lockdown, it would probably be a good idea if we did a cost-benefit analysis. And we wrote a paper showing that there was reason to believe that the public health consequences of lockdown would be far more severe than the consequences of not locking down. And that received some media traction and a whole lot of immediate vociferous criticism. But that wasn't the first insight that we had as an organization, a fledgling organization. The first thing that we had observed was propaganda. It was obvious at the very, very early stages of the coronavirus crisis that propaganda was at work. Think back to March, April, February even of last year, and you will remember the Chinese falling man videos. You will remember the fumigation of streets and these incredible, fantastical scenes that were pumped out onto the media and social media. Now, how many of those events have you seen in South Africa or in America? None. That was propaganda. And we saw it that way straight away. And the gap between what the media was saying and representing and the facts as they emerged, the cold, hard actuarial data, was enormous. And it terrified us and it spurred us into action. And that gap has remained. There are three foundational falsehoods that have been refuted time and time again by the data for more than a year from the very beginning. Those three falsehoods are as follows. First of all, the falsehood that asymptomatic transmission is a driver of the epidemic, which is the foundational lie that gets the healthy quarantined. Secondly, the doctrine that we are universally accepted susceptible to this disease is wrong. We saw from the very earliest data that the famous Diamond Princess cruise ship that the vast majority of any population was not going to be susceptible to this virus. And the third lie is the mode of spread, the idea that the virus is spread by droplets and fomites. Droplets as opposed to aerosols that float around in the breeze. So droplets that come out of your mouth when you spit or cough, and they travel and they come down to the earth. You've all seen the diagrams claiming this. Fomites being those droplets once they've landed on a solid surface. You can then apparently touch them and touch your mouth and become infected by the virus, which is not true. There is no, when I say no, there is zero evidentiary support for the notion that fomite and droplets are important in transmission of SARS-CoV-2. And that lie was incredibly important, because in the wake of that came all of the theater that we see. The idea of social distancing, of maintaining a 2-meter rule or a 6-foot rule. The idea of wearing a cloth mask to stop big droplets from spraying around you. The idea of using Perspex barricades and sanitizing your hands every 5 minutes. All of this is complete and utter nonsense, because it all rests on the assumption of droplet and fomite transmission. And it is only to be understood as part of the propaganda. Why do I say that? Because all of these things are part of the theater of COVID. If we didn't go out of our door every day and encounter people wearing cloth masks and see sanitizers on every table in a restaurant and at every doorway and stickers all over the place asking us to stand 1.5 meters apart or restricting the number of people or whatever, COVID would not be with us anywhere near the way it is.
Nee, kijk, het is nog steeds bij jou. Baie dankie vir daai kommentaar. Wat is jou ondervinding oor die verswijging van inlichting, vooral waar oor COVID-sterftes en gerapporteer moet word? Excuse, het ek deurgekom. Okay, I'll read it again. Wat is jou ondervinding oor die verswijging van vooral waar oor COVID-sterftes en entinggeskiedenis gerapporteer word?
So there are actually two problems. The first one is part of the theater has been the continual laying out in front of the public, the bombardment of the public with the daily statistics, always without any context. And that failure to give context is part of the lie. Every year in South Africa, approximately 500,000 people die, and we don't have a counter for them. When COVID official death counts of last year in the first wave hit 20,000, people forgot that the models that put us into lockdown predicted that there would be almost 400,000 deaths in that first wave. People just forget that because of the constant bombardment creates a mood of crisis and of panic and of fear. And when people are fearful, they lose their cognitive ability and they forget what started them being fearful in the first place. And that has happened. We are dealing much more with a psychosis, a mass psychosis, than we are dealing with a virus. That needs to be understood. When you make people fearful, they cannot think and they cannot remember. And our society is full of people at the moment who cannot think or remember. So the statistics and the abuse of statistics has been very severe. The prolific nature of it has been a big part of the problem. But there's also another type of manipulation that's going on, and that has been ignored so much by the media. This idea that you, as a result of somebody sticking a swab into your nose, sticking into a machine that's incredibly sensitive, and registering a red light, a flash, a PCR positive, the idea that such a person represents the case of a disease is absurd. It's completely inconsistent with anything that's ever been done in public health or medicine. And that gave rise to a massive exaggeration of the scale of the problem. And we saw the effect of that. Our government spent hundreds of millions on facilities that were never used. And that it did that after that same problem had occurred all over the world. The Nightingale Hospitals in London, the USS Mercy in New York, none of these facilities were utilized. They were built on the back of the models, and then the expectation that they were going to be filled was built on the back of this false premise that a PCR test represents a case of a disease. Even calling those tests COVID tests is a lie. They're SARS-CoV-2 tests at best. They are not COVID tests. They are not testing you for whether you are infected, infectious, or whether you have a disease called COVID.
Thank you. Dr. Edeling, wat is uw opinie over het ethische gedrag van ambtsdraers, van verenigings in die medische beroep? Is het professioneel en ethisch dat collega's in die openbaar gerepedieer word alvorens privaat met hulle in gesprek getree is?
Dion, ek moet jou vraag op 'n formele basis antwoord om 'n agtergrond te skep voor ek by die punt van jou vraag kan kom. En die rede dat ek dit so moet doen is ons lewe nou in 'n sprookieswêreld. baie van die vraag wat aan ons gevra word deur die media en wat mense vir ons vra is gebaseer op valse veronderstellings. En dit is onmoontlik om 'n etiese antwoord te gee op 'n vraag waarin die vooronderstelling van die vraag onwaar is. Want dit is oneties om onwaar te wees. So wat ek wil doen, ek wil op 'n baie eenvoudige manier stel die etiese pligte van geneesheere en apart van dit die etiese verpligting van gesondheidsowerhede en dan kan ons daai vraag antwoord. Die etiese verpligtinge van geneesheere in Suid-Afrika is vir baie jare baie goed uiteengesit in die handboeke van die etiese reëls van die HPCSA, Health Professions Council of South Africa. Daar's 16 boekies, daar's baie. Maar ek gaan dit vir jou opsom in die hoofpilare waarop hulle staan. En elke geneesheer is eties verplig om aan hierdie beginsels getrou te bly. Die eerste een is eerlikheid. Alles wat die geneesheer doen, moet eerlik wees. Die tweede een is bekwaamheid. Bekwaamheid sluit onder andere in dat jy moet behoorlik ingelig wees oor die toestand wat jy wil behandel of oor die toestand waaroor jy jou wil uitlaat. Want bekwaamheid sonder kennis van die werklikheid is nie bekwaam nie. Die derde een is respek. En dit is vir geneesheere nodig om te respekteer die menswaardigheid en die reg op vryheid van keuse van pasiënte. Die vierde een is alles wat jy doen vir jou pasiënt moet in die beste belang van die gesondheid van jou pasiënt wees. Jy mag nie laat jou eie belange of ander belange inmeng met die gesondheidsbelange van jou pasiënt nie. En die vijfde een is dat alles wat jy doen moet ook in belang wees van die gesondheid van die gemeenskap. So geneesheere moet eerlik wees, hulle moet bekwaam wees, hulle moet menseregte respekteer, hulle moet hulle eie pasiënte behandel vir hulle beswil, alles wat hulle doen moet in die beswil van die gemeenskap wees en in al daai is daar 'n oorwegende plig om geen skade te veroorsaak nie. So dit sal goed wees as mense en geneesheere 'n bietjie nadink oor wat in hierdie tyd aangaan, wat geneesheere doen en sê, en hoe dit vergelyk met daardie 6 pilare van mediese etiek. As ons dan kom by gesondheidsowerhede, om 'n owerheid te wees oor 'n beroep, moet die owerheid op die heel minste totaal getrou wees aan die etiek van die individu. So die Wêreldgesondheidsorganisasie, SAPRA, Departement van Gesondheid, NIH, almal van hulle moet op die heel minste daardie etiese beginsels van geneesheere nakom. Want hulle is in 'n verhewe posisie van gesag geplaas. Hulle moet beheer uitoefen oor wat geneesheere doen. So hulle moet gelyk of meer eties wees as geneesheere. Maar dan is daar addisionele etiese pligte wat op hulle skouers rus. En dit is navorsing. Een dokter in sy praktyk kan nie navorsing doen. Hy het nie die hulpbronne om dit te doen nie. Die gesondheidsowerhede het geld, hulle het mense, hulle het geriewe, hulle het bronne om navorsing te doen. So die plig is om oorsig te hou oor die gesondheid van die gemeenskap en te sien waar daar probleme is of gevare is of waar daar gapings in kennis is waar navorsing nodig is. Hulle moet navorsing loods om daai vraagstukke te antwoord. En in daai hele proses van navorsing moet hulle getrou bly aan die wetenskaplike metode. Nick Hudson het baie duidelik gesê, science is not an institution. Ons kan nie praat van the science. Wetenskap is 'n metode, dit is 'n benadering wie ten doen stel om die natuur te verstaan en om natuurverskynsels te ontleed, te verstaan wat hulle beteken. Dit is 'n soeke na die waarheid. Dit is wetenskap. So die beheerliggame moet navorsing doen wat getrou is aan die welbekende wetenskaplike metode. En dan die volgende een is dat die beheerliggame het die ethische plig om sinvolle, korrekte en waardige inligting bekend te maak om vir geneesheere te help om hulle werk te doen en om vir die publiek behoorlik in te lig hoe om vir hulle eie gesondheid te sorg. Dit is in opsomming die ethiese beginsels. As ons by hierdie pandemie kom, omdat daar soveel propaganda is, omdat ons in 'n sprookieswêreld lewe, dit is amper soos in die Matrix, daar is 'n werklike lewe en dan is daar 'n ander denkbeeldige lewe waarin ons verwag word om sekere goed te glo. Is dit vir my nodig om te weet in watter konteks word die vraag gestel? So word die vraag gestel in die konteks van die werklikheid of word dit gestel in die konteks van die amptelike storie wat vertel word? En daar is my teenvraag aan jou nou, Dion. Ek het die vermoë as jy dit verlang om in 'n hipotetiese stelling 'n hipotetiese antwoord te gee. As jy my wil vra om 'n onwerklike hipotese te oorweeg, dan kan ek dit antwoord. Maar dit moet duidelik wees dat ek antwoord 'n hipotese of ek antwoord 'n werklikheid.
Ek dink die antwoord is baie omvattend en baie duidelik. Baie dankie. Daar is 'n vraag wat deurgekom het op die WhatsApp, maar ek wil graag vir Dr. Pieter vra, want ek dink hierdie is 'n belangrike vraag. Ons hoor baie verwyte tussen enters en nie enters. Ek dink nie daar so 'n woord, ek dink hy het nou gebeur. Slegte gevolge word byna, kan 'n mens sê, mekaar toegewens. Ek dink hier aan die tragiese geval van Iris Adams, 'n gesondheidswerker wat pro-inenting was, ingeënt is en tragies oorlede is weens komplikasies wat met die virus verband hou. Wat is die ethiese manier waarop mense, en dit gaan nou die individu, onder die huidige omstandighede met mekaar moet handel?
I don't know that I fully understood the first part, the first few words I didn't comprehend.
There was this nurse,
yes.
Iris Adams, she died. She was pro-vaccination.
Yes.
And after she has been vaccinated, she died due to complications,
yes,
of COVID. So what I would like to ask is, people work with each other.
Yeah.
Some are vaccinated and some are not vaccinated. And there is a lot of attention between,
yes,
them. And my question is, what is the ethical way that people should treat each other in this circumstance?
Thank you. Terminology was used that missed my vodiskap is basis. Ek het kort gevoten Rhodesia. I think the most ethical basis always is to do unto others you want to be done unto yourself, and who wants to be treated with rudeness or be demonized or dismissed or treated like some kind of second-class citizen. So just throughout history, it's been understood that you try to be a good neighbor and you be considerate and thoughtful. And yet what this COVID cult propaganda, paranoia, panic mongering has done is it's split families. It's split marriages, it's split companies, churches. You know, there's those who, we must lock down, no, we mustn't lock down, we must vaccinate, no, we must vaccinate. And this is part of, to me, a communist strategy. It's confuse, divide, and conquer. Confuse, divide, and conquer. They want to keep us confused, they want to keep us divided, they want us to be fighting amongst one another. And I think it's just so important that one is allowed to have a common sense, rational discussion about these things on the basis of the evidence, and still respect people's conscience. Respect that people will have different opinions. And that's why the only way our society can work is devolution, decentralization, not more centralization. And the government has tried to deal with this the way governments always try to deal with this: pass more laws and penalize the people who don't do what they want, which is the way of tyranny, oppression. That's Babel, that's pyramid style, top down, no, not acceptable, which is why I've supported
independence and self-determination for the Western Cape for a long time, and I've just gotten more enthusiastic during this COVID nonsense. Give you one example. At the beginning of lockdown, there were 10,000 members of Cape Exit. Now, 18 months later, there are over 820,000 members of Cape Exit, who've grown from 10,000 to 820,000 just in the Western Cape, of people who support secession, because people are fed up with being bullied, pushed around, lied to, shoved around, and it's like, leave us alone. And yes, I would imagine that when the truth comes out, we will see that hundreds of thousands of people who were bullied into taking a vaccine against their better judgment will have died or been crippled as a result of this vaccine. I trust there'll be new Nuremberg trials for this violation of bioethics, because it is a crime. This is a crime against humanity. This is wicked, and this is the most serious power grab ever, and it's absolutely outrageous. Now, praise God for the courageous Dr. Susan Fosloos and the people who've made the stand, but realistically, the vast majority of people are not going to sacrifice their job and go against peer pressure and go against what their boss says. And so many will have the vaccination even though they feel it's the wrong thing to do. And who's going to take responsibility for the negative medical consequences? And how can you do anything when a person died? And there have been many cases like that. So again, it just shows, don't force people. When they had the flu epidemic and the vaccine came out for the bird flu, what was it, 20, 30 people died? They pulled it from the market. When the swine flu came out and there was something like 20 died, they pulled it from the market, canceled the whole thing. Here we can have tens of thousands, at least tens of thousands, possibly hundreds of thousands have died already from the vaccine. And at what point are they going to pull it? So yes, I think it's so important to go back to something as basic as love your neighbor, do to others you want to be done to, respect one another, and don't let any politicians or prostitutes stampede you by panic into mistreating and disrespecting and bullying the people that you work with, live with, and are neighbors with.
Nick, you will say?
I think it's important to pause and just to, in the clear light of day, to think about how crazy this situation has become. Prior to February of last year, you would have had no problem encountering a doctor who would tell you that a recovered person doesn't need to be vaccinated. Okay? The person who's had the disease, any disease, doesn't need the vaccine. His immune system is ready. Can handle it. He's proven it. Okay? In fact, you'd have a hard time finding a doctor who would contradict that. Recovered people do not need to be vaccinated, and any ethical doctor would contraindicate vaccination of a recovered person in almost all cases. The science, not surprisingly, finding that that is correct also for COVID is massive. We have piles and piles of papers showing that this is the case, that there's little to no benefit or in fact harms that come from putting a vaccine on top of a past infection. And the reason I'm talking about this is, as we sit here right now, somewhere between 70 and 80% of the South African population has had an infection of COVID, an infection of SARS-CoV-2 and recovered. So I'll join the dots one step further. That means vaccination should not be mandated for 70 or 80% of the population. It should be contraindicated. That is basic medical logic, and I defy any doctor to sit next to me and tell me why that is false.
Dion, ek is 'n dokter en ek sit langs hom. En ek bevestig dat alles wat hy gesê het is die waarheid.
It gets crazier than that, I'm afraid. Okay? Young people, from the very beginning, have not been at risk. COVID exposes healthy young children to negligible risk. Something like 1 in 1,000,000 of children who get infected and sick from COVID actually die from COVID. And in most cases, when investigations are done, it pertains to those horrifying, sad cases of children with cancers, and that kind of thing. And this has been obvious from the beginning. In fact, the infection fatality rate for an old person is about 1,000 times higher than the infection fatality rate for a young person. What this more or less means is that, thank heavens, children are already immune. The features of their, what is known as their innate immune system, are such that the virus simply does not present a threat to them. And in fact, an infection at a young age sets them up for life, because it teaches the immune system the full, florid, broad response to this specific virus, which will be with us forever, probably. To go and say that those kids need to be vaccinated, once again, the vaccination should be contraindicated for them, because the harms are clear. The harms are absolutely clear. There is a very real risk of myocarditis, of pericarditis. Why would you do this to a child? And yet these damn fanatics who are insistent that there must be a jab in every arm want to inject every recovered person and every young person. There is something demonic, something deeply evil about this, and it needs to stop.
Yes. Dion, ek wil net aansluit by wat Nick nou gesê het. Weet jy, voor die eerste mRNA-inspuiting gegee is ons verbeloof, daar sal 'n ding wees wat effektief en veilig is, dit gaan die pandemie beëindig. Mens kan op 'n manier aanvaar dat dokters en mense daai tyd geglo het, dit sal so wees. Die inentings het begin laat in 2020 en vroeg 2021, in ander lande voor het hierso begin het. So daar is lande in die wêreld soos Israel en Amerika en in Engeland, wat voor ons begin het, met ander woorde, hulle het 'n langer termyn ervaring. Nou, die inligting wat tans beskikbaar is, van vaksingevare en effektiviteit, en dit is net in die kort termyn, want dit is 'n paar maande, dit is minder as 'n jaar. In hierdie tydperk van minder as 'n jaar, is daar reeds bewyse dat hierdie inentings veroorsaak meer skade as wat dit help, en ook inligting dat dit maak meer mense dood as wat dit lewens red. Nou, as mens dit weet, en mens dink, wat kan in die toekoms gebeur? Die bloedstolproses wat begin is as gevolg van die vaksine, en die abnormale immuunreaksies wat begin is as gevolg van die vaksine, kan in die langtermyn niks anders doen as om groter insidensie van degeneratiewe siektes soos Alzheimer en hartaanvalle en beroertes te veroorsaak, auto-immuunsiektes soos Guillain-Barre, en baie belangrik, onderdrukking van die immuunsysteem wat teen kanker moet beskerm. So, in 'n jaar se tyd gaan die sterftesyfer van vaksines baie hoër wees, en in 2 jaar se tyd nog hoër. In 10 jaar se tyd sal almal weet, dit was 'n verskriklike slegte eksperiment. Maar die feit is, dit is nou, vandag, is die bewyse is klaar daar. En daarom vir enig iemand om nou nog voort te gaan met druk op enig iemand anders om hierdie vaksine te kry, is nie net oneties, dit is krimineel.
Dames en heren, ons het nou basis nog 5 minute van hierdie paneelbespreking oor. Net ook vraag, ek wil graag een paar, ons gehoor ook deel maak van om een paar vrae te gee. Kan ek die dame dalk 'n vraag vra?
You explained so nicely about the virus not being spread with droplets and foaming and so on at the mouth. But how is it spread? That's what I'd like. And the mRNA, what does it do? Please, thank you.
So, science is a project of uncertainty, and we are always trying to push back or to penetrate the world that we don't know. And viruses are very tiny. Viruses are there's much more we don't know about viruses than what we know about viruses. The evidence for transmission of all types is actually quite weak, but the strongest evidence is in favor of what's known as aerosol transmission. And aerosol particles are little, let's call them little particles that don't obey the laws of gravity in a way, and the reason is they're too small. So gravity doesn't have the dominant effect on them. They float around in the air. They don't fall to the ground, precipitate. They don't land on stuff. And I would say that if you have been reading the literature on transmission, as our scientists have been doing, then the support you need to lend is towards the aerosol theory of transmission. That means that if I'm sick and I go into a room and I breathe in there for several hours, there will be aerosol particles with virus on them in the room. Long after I've left, it can stay suspended in the air for days. And that's why we can see straight away something in the real world that's consistent with that idea, which is that transmission seems to take place where there are A, lots of sick people, and B, inside, indoors. Outdoor transmission in environments like this, I actually cannot stand seeing a person wearing a mask on the outdoors. I mean, masks don't work. Cloth masks do not work. They cannot stop aerosol-borne viruses. But to see somebody outside wearing a mask for me is just soul-destroying. I can't do it. So it's what we see is that almost all transmission of this disease takes place in what are called nosocomial settings, your hospitals and your nursing homes. And we have said from the beginning, from day one, don't spend trillions shutting down the whole of society and trying to close down restaurants and businesses and all that. Take a fraction of that money and spend it on improving the ventilation in hospitals or nursing homes, and you'll cut out a lot of the deaths.
Yes, indeed.
Such a simple thing. We've said that from the beginning. Could we get one person to listen? No. mRNA, I'm going to hand over to Dr. Edelung. I sort of know, but he'll do a better job.
Ek gaan jou 'n baie kort verduideliking gee oor mRNA. In elke sel van ons lichaam is daar DNA, dis ons genetiese kode. Die sel moet proteïene vervaardig. Die DNA maak 'n spieelbeeld van homself, wat mRNA genoem word. Daardie mRNA gaan buite die nukleus in die sel en veroorsaak die vorming van 'n proteïen. So die spesifieke mRNA sê, maak nou albumin of maak nou beta globulin of wat 'n proteïen ook al. Dit is die natuurlike proses. Nou wat hulle vir jou inspuit is mRNA wat die boodskap dra om coronavirus spike proteïen te vervaardig. So daai mRNA gaan in nanoparticles in jou arm in, dit versprei deur jou liggaam, dit kom na selle oral in jou liggaam wat dit binnendring, dan gaan daai mRNA wat 'n virus mRNA is, dis nie 'n menslike mRNA, gee dan die instruksie vir jou sel om coronavirus alpha variant spike protein te vervaardig. En jou liggaam vervaardig triljoene kopieë van daardie spike protein, en dit is in werklikheid die patogeen. Dit is die gifstof wat in die SARS coronavirus toe is. So jy word 'n fabriek wat gifstof vervaardig. En nou hoop jy, jou immuunsysteem sal slim genoeg wees om nou immuniteit teen hierdie aanval te veroorsaak. En waar die ding kom, is nie waar jou liggaam gewoond is nie. Pieter het gepraat van God se gebooie. Ek gaan praat oor God se gesondheid. God het vir ons 'n immuunsysteem gegee, wat verskriklik ingewikkeld en slim en effektief is. Mense asem patogene in deur die neus. Die eerste linie van God se immuniteit is in die slijmvlies van jou neus. Om dit skielik in jou selle van jou liggaam en in jou bloedsomloop te kry, dis nie waar dit moet wees nie. En vir verskeie redes wat ons nie nou sal bespreek nie, is die immuunreaksie verkeerd en sleg en maak jou siek.
Just a quick addition to that, there's actually an important point that comes from that. It's very important to understand that by the very mechanism of action of the mRNA vaccine, we do not expect it to prevent a person from becoming infected or from being able to transmit the virus. By design, this vaccine can't do those things. Okay? And that's why, to answer the earlier question from Dion, nobody should have an interest in whether somebody else is vaccinated. Vaccinated, unvaccinated, you can be infected, you can transmit. This idea that there's a pandemic of the unvaccinated and that unvaccinated people are dangerous to somebody who's vaccinated, it's complete nonsense. Complete nonsense.
Dames en heren, ek moet ongelukkig die paneelbespreking nou tot einde bring, want daar is een volgende gedeelte ook wat moet gebeur. Kan ek dalk net in enkele sin van elkeen van die net gedachte, wat is voorop in die gedachtes op hierdie stadium? Wie wil eerst begin? Pieter?
Let's live as free people, unvaccinated, unintimidated, don't back down. Whatever we do, let's make sure that we can, in this year, 2021, this is the 500th anniversary of one of the most important speeches ever, Professor Martin Luther in 1521, standing before the emperor and the entire power of the Holy Roman Empire, being ordered to recant, he said, I will not recant. To go against my conscience is dangerous and unsafe. Popes and councils have often erred and contradicted themselves. My conscience has kept the word of God. Here I stand, I can do no other, so help me God. Let's have more people going back to their conscience on the 500th anniversary of that great speech.
Vertrou in God. Respekteer jouself en respekteer mekaar.
I'm going to end with an appeal to everybody. This stops when we make it stop. Every time you pick up that spritzer bottle of disinfectant, fill in that form, wear that mask, you are an active participant in the greatest lie that has ever been told. This stops when we make it stop. I want you all to not comply with this nonsense anymore. Thank you.
Dames en heren, ek wil vir ons paneel sê baie dankie. Ons het twee van die paneellede van Kaapstad afgekom, Dr. Edeling van Johannesburg, hulle het baie moeite gedoen. Ons sê vir hulle baie dankie, dit was wat my aan betref werklik die moeite werd.